Hello, welcome to Painting Like Rembrandt. And I'm just going to try to, in this preliminary stage, I need a reference photo to work from. And I'm going to try to set up the light. And I looked at some Rembrandt images, and I noticed that he tends to use what's called form lighting. So I'm just going to get my phone here, get my flashlight on my phone. And form lighting generally means that the light is coming at a 45 degree angle down this way onto your face. And this is how Rembrandt made a lot of his portraits, actually. So you just kind of play around with this lighting until it gets into the right place. And he had a hot spot kind of here on the head. Rembrandt did do a lot of paintings with hats, even though the bill represents this kind of harsh 45 degree angle. And of course, this side of the face was in shadow, and this side was kind of the hot side generally. So we're just going to play around with the distance of the light here and look for the right angle. Right? So I'm holding with my right hand the light, and then with my left hand, I can just hit the shutter and take a photo of the portrait. Cool, so I got my photo, and I've got my reference photo to look at here, opened in Photoshop. If you don't have Photoshop, you can download GIMP for free. It does a lot of the same things. So here's my photo, and obviously I'm going to have to crop it and figure out how much space should the head take up in a Rembrandt painting. So here we can see that it was his eye line was about one third of the way down. And that kind of works with this idea of the rule of thirds, which means you put interesting things about a third of the way into the painting. At the end here is another third, right? So we have one third there, one third here. So I'm going to look at my photo, and I'm going to try to crop it in a similar manner. I have these guidelines that can actually show me where a third is. And this should give me an idea how big my head should be. How far? His head is pretty close to the top, so that's another big difference there. So we're going to do this. Okay, that's about right. And so now we've got a photo with about the same size head as in the Rembrandt. Light is coming from a similar direction. And we'll get into the first stage here in a second. Cool, so the picture still doesn't look Rembrandt-y enough. So I just keep looking back at my source material here, and I took up the levels and just started blackening things out. Put in a brown background to give some contrast to the face here. And as we can see here, Rembrandt often would have the shoulders come down on the inside of the painting. They didn't go outside of the frame. So I changed mine accordingly. And the dark foreground image, the dark clothing here is also very important. So we darken that out. I cut this part of my neck out just because there was way too much neck. And we don't see a lot of neck here. Focus should be more on the face than this big giant neck area. So I'll probably darken this too in the actual painting. And then just darkened up the clothing and got rid of the Totoro on my hat. So now we got to, you know, it's starting to get a little Rembrandt-y already. Not bad for a DIY setup in the storage area, and a phone flashlight. So we've got our lighting right, we've got our composition about right, our head's about the right size, and now we're going to get into charcoal drying onto the canvas. So at this stage I've got my imprimatura painted onto my masonite here, and got my source material up here, and basically what all I'm going to be using is some charcoal. This is just vine charcoal, and this allows you to erase pretty easily. And from my research, I've pretty much found out that Rembrandt liked to work from large areas of mass, so I'm just trying to catch those big areas of darks and lights and get a general idea where these two, well, more than two, where all these different value shapes lie within the painting. So currently I'm just going to draw it in with this vine charcoal, and I'm going to try to get my dark, a mid, and a light, and just an overall shape of where the portrait's going to lie.
One of the thirds. I'm kind of trying to use that same third, rule thirds in this painting. So I'm just going to come down there somewhere.
Okay, so I've got a basic charcoal drying now on my canvas. Probably have too much charcoal on there, so I'm just gonna blow it off. And this gives me an idea of the big basic masses, right? Obviously this isn't perfect, but this drawing is mainly meant to be a guide on how to work into the next stage. So, let's go there. So, for this stage, we know that Rembrandt tended to paint with his darks first, which was how most of his contemporaries painted. And I'm just going to start off, and he would start with the darks being very, very thin. So, I'm just going to take a little bit of paint thinner, add a little bit of liquin to it. That's my magic mystery mix. And I'm gonna make a really liquidy layer, right? And since I need this to dry fast, I've made the ultimate drying mix, which is liquin and cobalt. So combined with black, this stuff should just distill some burnt sienna there. And a good rule of thumb to remember is in these initial stages you should never use any white. So you can see how limited my palette is here. No blue. And we're just trying to loosely block all this stuff in. I'm using a brush that I don't care about too much. I can really abuse this brush a lot. Just an old flat. Might as well be a bristle brush. It's been around for a while. Sorry, I have a bit of a cold, so that's why I have to clear my throat all the time. And a good thing is to just act like you know how to draw really well. Because obviously these guys could draw ridiculously well. A lot of this painting is going to be coming later, probably fixing it when you have to commit to so much in the beginning. Rembrandt, of course, was known to often paint with his fingers, so don't be afraid to get smudgy with it. That value shape goes in there. Ah, I'm getting too caught up. Don't get so caught up in the little things. Keep going fast. Eyeballs. Nah. And we're just establishing the way that light is going to hit the face right now. Like I said, my photo, I've got the same color neck as my face, but I'm just going to change that in the painting. Just going to take a little bit of an ochre, mix it into that mix to lighten it. We want to keep all of our colors really warm and rich at this stage. My dog Jedi holding down the fort. Part of this is drawing, part of this is trying to figure out the lights. But trying to keep loose. As you can see, this is going to be a multi-part... Jedi! Ticho! Boitsem! Sedni! Alehni! Dog is freaking out. Nice. Just found a cheese puff on the floor that she ate, which is good. Alright. Do I dare put that in? Can see how these woof. Just kind of playing back and forth between these two. Remember, a lot of the drawing for this is going to come later, fixing this stuff up. We got to make sure the eyes and the nose and that stuff are all in the right place, of course, now. But these fine details, we got to get in the habit of doing those later. Wow, look at that. Way off there on that drawing. But, yeah, painting is fixing. A lot of the time you're just fixing. The only reason I'm putting a little white in is because I'm dumb. It's just because I'm dumb. Bye. Thought I could establish that eye better, but I just can't. Look at how much that little bit of white is infecting that now. A little bit of white went against my rule, and now everything is falling apart. Okay. You know, that eye is basically in the dark. I'm just going to put it in the dark. We'll carve out the white later. No use in trying to act like it's not dark. And one thing that Rembrandt often did was he would use the color of the ground and the thickness of the paint to make different values. So we can use the rag to kind of draw a little bit. Clearly that ear is wonk central. Okay, time to get something in the back. His backgrounds tended to be a little bit lighter. It's the only reason I'm going to steal a little bit of that. And a lot of ochre. And let's get that back established. And for this, this is going to be kind of the end of the first stage. Just going to get rid of that gray. And at this stage, we're going to have our our lightest lights are just going to be these yellows for now. It's going to look a little weird, but the future will all work out. And we're starting off very thinly because only the highlights would tend to be painted opaque, and we don't have our drawing to the point where we can know how those are going to work. So we're just going with a little bit of yellow ochre, is as light as we can get. This is obviously really coming in farther more here. This is so much thinner than I ever paint. It's so weird for me to do it. But I'm kind of starting to see things a little differently, which I guess is kind of the point of these copies, right? So this obviously comes down here. This is a really major difference here. I don't know how that happened. You know what else I'm going to do? I'm going to just mix up some warmer colors, since getting a little bit too much of the same color going on. just to make things a little bit more rich. Looking through the camera, this red is coming through much different than it is on the canvas, but we'll fix that all in post, right? Okay, so that's about it for step one. We've got, you know, a pretty wonky underpainting, but it's starting to give some indication of where our, you know, a lot of these different values are going to lie. And we'll get into the next step in just a second. Just kind of continuing to paint here, and wanted to give you a close-up as I continue to fix this drawing. One thing we know that Rembrandt did was he'd often use the back of his brush to draw. So you can see just by making some lines with your brush, you can figure out where certain values are supposed to lie. Remember, this stage is still just drawing. And then on the other side, I'm just going to use a little bit of black. You can see just how wet everything still is. Treating everything still very loosely, but just beginning to kind of really clean up where things lie. But this gives you an idea just how this paint actually moves. Again, we're not using any lights. If we need lights, we just, you know, erase, use the light of the canvas, or use your finger. If you need to blend certain areas, corners. So the way you approach it at this stage is almost kind of a mixture of charcoal drawing and painting. Because everything is still very light, very loose. But we're starting to get those important drawing areas laid in. Yeah, just using the little bit of black. And if you need to make a big change, of course, you can scratch the back of your brush. Oil paint takes a long time to dry, so I'm going to spray my painting with this Damar varnish, which is a fast, super fast drying Damar varnish. It's probably a bad idea because you're supposed to let your paints dry completely before adding layers to them, but, you know, I ain't got time for that. So I'm just going to spray it with some Damar varnish here. Cool, so look at that now. Dry within 1 hour. Amazing, isn't it? So I'm gonna just mix up a glaze, which is gonna just be black and red. See that? Maybe if you wanna put a little bit of yellow ochre, you can. And we're just gonna start glazing this whole painting. Kinda testing it in the areas it doesn't matter as much. Obviously, one of the time-consuming aspects of Rembrandt's paintings was all this time it took for just to glaze stuff. But these thin glazes give a lot of texture. And one of the things he was particularly amazing at was actually having these textures. Like when he would scrape out areas with the brush, sometimes around the eyes or something, he'd actually create little indentations. So when this type of a glaze he'd put on top of it would be like this, it gets into all those little cracks. See how the paint sits in the cracks, and in the little crack areas it's actually a little bit darker? Like right there, that little tiny line, it's a little bit darker. So, just to give you an idea of how genius Rembrandt actually is compared to me, he would actually have those tiny little cracks, the little tiny brush marks, would also make the drawing. Now obviously this is super dark, but that's okay. We want it to be really dark. Like I said, the lights are the last thing put in, and believe it or not, I just mix a little bit of thinner with this mixture right here, which is just black and red, and the Damar varnish underneath, since it's so freshly sprayed, actually mixes a little bit with the thinner and dries it relatively quick. So, tune in for part 2.